Good evening. Welcome to worship. Glad that you can be with us here on a nice chilly evening. Hopefully all is going well. I know you're all in a good mood because Nebraska did not lose, so that is good. But they do have to play next week, so we'll see how that goes. Our service begins with confession and forgiveness. You can find that on page 94 in the front of the red hymnal as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship. We gather in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. We'll take a few moments of silence to confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another, and to where we have given love, and to where we have received the love of God. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. The mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ, was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sin. And as a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by Christ's authority, I therefore declare to you the forgiveness of that sin, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And our gathering song is in the back of the red hymnal, number 652. Number 652, as we sing verses 1 and 2. The Lord be with you. Almighty God, your sovereign purpose brings salvation to birth. Give us faith to be steadfast amidst the tumults of this world, trusting that your kingdom comes and your will is done. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And at this time, we will now have readings from Scripture.
The first reading is from Hebrews, the 10th chapter, beginning at the 11th verse. And every priest stands day after day at his service, offering again and again the same sacrifices that can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God. And since then has been waiting until his enemies would be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering he has perfected for all time those who are sanctified. And the Holy Spirit also testifies to us, for after saying, "This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, said the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds." He also adds, "I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more." Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. The word of the Lord.
Hi, welcome to another children's message from here at First Lutheran Church in Blair, Nebraska. This past week, our church lost a dear, dear friend, Lorraine Hansen. And Lorraine was the ultimate hero of the children's ministries here at First Lutheran. We are going to miss her dearly. She has been involved in every child's life here at First Lutheran for many, many years. And she used to teach the three-year-old Sunday school class. And I remember each of my children having her as a teacher, and she kept track of them. As they grew older, as they went into confirmation, and as they graduated, she kept track and she knew every single one of them. And she loved each of them so much. We're going to miss Lorraine. She was a Sunday school teacher. She was a member of our children's ministries team. She assembled all of the faith chests for our newly baptized members. She did a lot of things to share God's love with especially the children of our church. So today I want to honor her. I am down here in the children's wing of our church, right here in front of our faith tree. That reminds me of Lorraine because she's one of these really strong branches. She's a foundation for us. She established so much here for the kids, and her legacy will be God's love for all of us and to make sure that we share that love with the children here at First Lutheran. So in honor of Lorraine, I wanted to read a story because she had many, many, many books in her little office to share with kids. So I went in there and I found this little one, and it's called Jesus is Our Good Shepherd. Jesus is our good shepherd. Do you see that shepherd with his sheep? He loves his sheep. He takes good care of them. "I am your good shepherd," Jesus told his friends, "and he is our good shepherd too." Jesus loves us like the shepherd loves his sheep. He takes good care of us like a good shepherd should. Thank you, Jesus, for loving me. Thank you, Jesus, for taking good care of me. The end. Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for sharing Lorraine with us for so many years. Thank you for teaching us so many good things through her. We will miss her, but we know that she is with you in heaven, rejoicing and laughing, and I'm sure reading stories to all those little children up there. Lord, we ask that you be with Lorraine's family and remind them of your love. Thank you for all the blessings you have given us, and I ask that you be with each of us this week as we go about our normal everyday lives and remember to keep you in those normal everyday moments. In your name we pray. Amen. All right. I hope you all have a great week. As we get ready for Thanksgiving, remember to be grateful. Remember to find something that you're thankful for every day. I love you all, and I hope I see you soon. Bye-bye.
The Holy Gospel this evening comes from St. Mark in the 13th chapter. Glory. So as Jesus came out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what large stones and what large buildings." And then Jesus asked him, "Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left here upon another. All will be thrown down." And while he was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will this be, and what will be the sign that all these things are about to be accomplished?" And then Jesus began to say to them, "Beware that no one leads you astray. Many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and they will lead many astray. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is still to come. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines. This is but the beginning of the birth pangs." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you. So, back in the day when I was going to school, which gets farther and farther every moment, there was usually the consensus that the story of the Gospel of Mark and where Jesus looks at the temple and says, you know, someday this place is going to all come tumbling down, was written before the temple actually came tumbling down. In the year 70, the Roman army, having tired of the Jewish presence in their midst, constantly bothering and badgering them around that portion of the eastern part of the Mediterranean Sea, destroyed the Jewish temple, leveled it to the ground, and all that remains today is what we know as the Wailing Wall. So when I was learning about this, it was as if Jesus was telling the people that this is going to come into the future. This temple will not be there anymore. Well, I've since discovered over the years that scholarship is changing a little bit, and there are more and more scholars who are wondering if indeed Mark was written after the temple actually fell down. Because you see, if the temple hadn't fallen down when Mark was first written, that means Jesus is predicting the future, and Mark is using the prediction of Jesus into the future to find a way to warn us that there's going to be these cataclysmic events, and that we'd best call the midwives because things are going to get difficult soon and labor is going to get intense. But the Gospel of Mark was written after the temple had actually been torn down. Then Mark is writing as a reflection and trying to say that I know that the temple has been torn down, but God still works in our midst. There is still the presence of God. And all these things that we hear about, these earthquakes, these famines, they are ushering in a new reality for us. I got to confess, I don't know which way I stand on this. But I will say this, if you think about that text that Esther just read for us from the book of Hebrews, what the writer of Hebrews wants us to see is that Jesus Christ is constantly finding a way to help us survive the tumults of life, to find ways that we can get through all the vicissitudes of change and ways in which we live and move and have our being, often outside of our control, or things that we might even desire or want. And how do we then continue to maintain the faith? And indeed, that is the reason why we build buildings. institutions, as it were, in order to find ways that we can ground ourselves amidst all the change, to ground ourselves in the ways in which we can begin to make sense of things that are so ambiguous or weird or paradoxical or whatever particular thing baffles you on this day. And so we look at this building itself here, and for the first 30 years of my career as I preached on this text, I was wondering what it would be like to have a congregation or a church without a building. And then lo and behold, COVID-19 came around and said, let me show you. Because what we discovered more than anything, right, was that not being able to gather here and worship like this, chilly as it may be in this room, and we're going to work on that somehow, I hope, that we could actually worship God. Wasn't our preferred way to do it, whether it was at home or watching it on TV or watching it on the internet or having a little celebration cups instead of actual bread and wine, celebrated communion. But we made it through somehow. Our relationship with God may have been strained and tenuized, but for many of us, we continued to find ways that we could worship God without gathering in a building, without these stones. And indeed, it seems like Jesus is trying to tell the disciples, especially those four who are sitting there in the Mount of Olives with him as they're looking at the temple and all its magnificent glory, and trying to say that it is okay for your faith to not have to have a building to anchor it, because your faith is anchored in something else, namely Jesus Christ and his death and resurrection. And whatever building you may or may not have is secondary to that relationship that Jesus has established with you through his death and through his resurrection. And in those waters of baptism that travel with you, no matter what building you go to, you can continue to find ways to worship God, to participate in God's mission for the world, and find ways that you can celebrate the glory that God has brought to your life and the perseverance that God brings you when things are not nearly as rosy or cheery, or the news is not happy. We know that. We learned it. We survived through COVID-19. So now the question is, well, what do we do with this thing now that we got it? This wonderful church. I brought some of my colleagues in from Washington County were visiting us on Thursday morning, and I brought them in here, and a couple of them have never been in this room before, and maybe it's been a long time since you've looked at it, but you know, being that this came out of a Danish tradition, the design of this sanctuary is designed to look like what? When you look up, what do you see? You see the hull of a ship. All right, that's very, very important in the Danish tradition. They're seafaring people by and large, and the idea that Jesus and many of the early disciples lived on the edge of the sea, Peter himself was a fisherman. That idea that we are sitting on an inverted ship, this ark, this place, is valuable and important to us. In fact, it's not uncommon for me to come through here at 10 o'clock on a Tuesday morning, or even 6 o'clock on a Thursday night, or whenever I happen to be here, and there will be a person sitting in one of these pews, just sitting, looking up at this cross. Because to have a place, to have something that can anchor your faith is important to us. And we know that we can worship God anywhere at any time. We do not need a building like this in order for God's grace to fill us. In fact, for many of us, God's grace has come in many places besides this building or others like it. It comes in the birth of a child, the marriage of a spouse. It comes in the ways in which we can celebrate an exciting time in our lives, and to see and to hear God's grace there is imperative, or to be at the bedside of a long-standing friend suffering the last throes of cancer. I mean, whatever it may be, we've seen God's grace in places other than this. We know it exists. So then what do we do with this building? Do we then just say it's no longer needed and not necessary? I mean, it's a pretty cool building. And indeed, we know in the back of our minds that our faith with God does not depend on the building upon which we worship or in the building which we worship, much as Jesus was trying to tell those disciples. But what this building is helpful for, what this building really is, and it's kind of sneaky how it does it, because you didn't really notice how this building was working on you. But what it does, right, is it lets other people in on your relationship with God too. You see, you're not sitting here alone. There are 35, 40 of us in this room right now. Why? Because that's what the building provides. A place not only for you to connect with God, but for other people to connect with God. And as you connect with God, you are now joined by this cloud of witnesses that's sitting right next to you. Some of them are family and friends. Others you may not know. But nonetheless, this is what the building does. And we don't think about it. We just think it's going to church because we come usually for ourselves, or maybe if we've made dinner arrangements with the people that we're going to be sitting next to, we might do it for that. But by and large, we're focused on our relationship with God and the building for that. But from my perspective, I don't see one worshiper. I see many. If you were to stand here and preach, you wouldn't see an individual, although many of you I know individually. But what I see is our collective. Our collective understanding that this building allows us to gather at this time and place, although next week, remember, it's going to be an hour earlier. You'll already be through your appetizer and your first beer by now. We gather and use this building as a way in which we can be together with other people who then can support us. You know, we're going to have another funeral coming up on Tuesday. Lorraine Hansen, many of you may know her. She passed away. And her funeral is Tuesday morning. And this building is designed to bring all the people of Lorraine's life that she knows, her family, her friends, those who haven't seen her for a long time, those who just saw her last week, to come together. Not only to be able to celebrate her life, but to be able to celebrate the gift and promise of God who keeps a deep relationship with Lorraine, even now as she understands God differently than you and I, as she has passed through the veil of death. So these buildings, whether it's the temple in Jerusalem or our building here on 21st and Wright Street, these buildings are designed to get us to understand that we are in this relationship with God, not alone, but together. And that we continue to find ways in which we can do what God calls us to do here. I mean, I'll give you this question. Before the pandemic, we averaged about 300 people a week in worship. This service, the two services on Sunday, and our Wednesday evening service. So, based on your experience, how many people worshiped here last week? The answer was about 285. In other words, almost the same. And the 15 people that we've lost, it's because we've done over 50 funerals in the last 20 months. So don't think that there's less people coming here. It's not true. Same amount of people are coming here unless they died. There may be a switch and a little bit of changing of which service people go to, but the numbers, from my perspective, are very similar. In this congregation is solidly built to move into the future. There are very few concerns that we have for our congregation in terms of things like money or resources or people or finances. I mean, Lord, we moved 450 quilts out of here 2 weeks ago, and we weren't even open. This is an amazing place. And this building, although it's not important that we maybe use it to worship God, it is certainly a place where we can celebrate God giving us gifts, God giving us talents, God giving us resources.
And so we celebrate this to the glory of God. Not because God is exclusively in a little cup and wafer, or God is exclusively in some water, but rather we celebrate that God is everywhere, and here we can gather together with family and friends and make that celebration even more valuable and more important as we connect up. And in our case, coming back from the pandemic, reconnecting, re-ligamenting, as it was. You know, if you think about it, right, we were separated, and just like if you had a knee injury or something like that, your ligaments go all over the place, and you got to reconnect those ligaments in that knee so that the knee can function. And by the way, the Latin word for re-ligamenting is religion. It might be what you think you're doing right now. Reconnecting with family and friends. Reconnecting with God, using this place, not to venerate this place over and above God or even over and above your friends, but rather to use this as a place in which we can celebrate what God has given us. We can, as our stewardship committee wants us to understand, be blessed to be a blessing to others. To use the gifts, the resources that God has found our way, whether it's our humor, or whether it's our hospitality, whether it's our financial resources, whatever it might be, to find ways that we can go out and be a blessing to others. And it is amazing what our congregation has been able to do, even in the midst of this pandemic. And you will be surprised come January when you look at the benchmarks and parameters that we show for our congregation, that 2021 was a pretty good year. I know it doesn't seem like it. I know it seems like it was the hardest year of your life. I know you wouldn't want to do it again. But for our congregation, collectively working under the grace of God through the power of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit, pretty good year. Because that's how God works. God works through us and with us. And yeah, we're tired sometimes. Yeah, we're frustrated. Yeah, we don't always get what we want. But that's okay. There's always tomorrow. And should the time come when there is no tomorrow for you or me or whomever, well, that's why there's God. Because our future rests not in how good we are or how strong we are or whether our children are all above average. Our future rests with God, not with a building, not even with a little cup of grape juice. It rests with God. And when you go through those doors tonight, you go perhaps with a good experience. You heard a fun hymn. You were able to say some prayers for somebody that you miss. But you go with God. That's the key. That's what Jesus tried to tell the disciples. That's what the writer of Hebrews was trying to tell his congregation. That's what we're trying to live here. That these buildings are great, and we love them. But they're here to remind us about how great God is and how much more we love God. Amen. We'll sing our hymn of the day, number 438. 438.
As we end this season of Pentecost, we are telling the story of God's love using the Apostles' Creed. You can find the Apostles' Creed on page 105 in the front of your red hymnal, and I invite you to join with me as we say together the story of God's love in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Eternal God, you hold firm amidst the changes of this world. Hear us now as we pray for the world and everyone in need. I'll end each petition, God, in your mercy, you may respond, hear our prayer. God, our Creator, you show us the path of life. Bless people everywhere with humility as we extend compassion to those who have experienced harm. Cultivate healthy congregations that tell and enact your reconciling love. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, our ruler, you write your law on human minds and hearts. Give wisdom to all people to serve with insight and compassion. Make us mindful of the well-being of all people, especially those ostracized by their color or gender or sexuality, so that your world will continue to flourish. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And God, our guide, you are greater than we can imagine. Surround congregations with your expansive love. Be present in the midst of our disagreements, differences, and questions. And may the umbrella of Christ's freedom unite us in service to you. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, our beginning and our end. Your beloved people shine like the brightness of the sky. We thank you for the lives of all who rest in your eternal mercy, from famous artists to people we have loved. And especially on this evening, we remember Lorraine Hansen, Arland Gross, Dick Veracruz, Kenneth Wilson, Kurt Peterson, Don Anderson, Darvid Quist, Pat Hunchy, John Tess, Ralph Novak, Jet Andreessen, and all those whom we name in our hearts. Continue, God, to assure us of your resurrection promise. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And God, our hope and strength, we entrust to you all for whom we pray. Remain with us always, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. During this time of COVID, we are not processing the communion or the offering forward in order to minimize movement during this time. But in honor of those gifts and donations, let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us and what we have gathered in feeding the world with your love, through the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. We prepare our hearts and minds for Holy Communion. Let us pray. Gracious God, we remember on the night in which he was betrayed, Our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this to remember me." And that after supper he took the cup, blessed it, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this to remember me." For as often as we eat from this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim our Lord's death and resurrection until he comes again. And so let us pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Once again this evening, Holy Communion will be distributed out to you. We are using our celebration cups still, which have the wafer on top and the grape juice underneath. Also note that during the distribution, we are singing hymn number 481, and you can join in on that at any time. The body of Christ is given for you, and the blood of Christ is shed for you.
Now may the body and the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace, now and always. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of life. In your mercy, strengthen us through this gift in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another, for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
We have a couple of announcements this evening, but first off, remember, like I said, next week we'll be out of here by now. We are moving this service up to 5 o'clock in the afternoon, so please note that, set it on your phone or whatever you have to do for that, but we'll be moving it to 5 o'clock, and hopefully that will allow people to participate as it gets darker. They can still find ways to make it over here. And then also note that we have a couple of, we're working with the Three Rivers Health Department here. We've got a flu shot clinic tomorrow morning from 7:30 to 11:30. So if you would like a flu shot, that's going to be over here. It'll be out in the fellowship hall done by Three Rivers. And then also note that on Monday, we have a COVID-19 vaccine shot for kids from 3 to 5:30 p.m. So if you have kids or grandkids 8 to 11 who would like to participate in a COVID vaccine with parent approval, that's coming up on Monday the 15th. And then note that there is holiday greenery available. There's a little sign-up sheet out in the narthex there. The youth are selling that for one of their fundraisers. And the craft fair is coming up as well, and they are still looking for a few more volunteers, and they're on the Welcome Center, so take a look at that. Is from our Social Concerns Committee here on the screen with an announcement.
Globally, over 1 billion people are hungry. That's 1 in 6 people. And in the United States, over 14% of families are struggling to put food on the table. 1 in 4 children in this country is at risk of hunger. These are shocking statistics, because we as Christians know that God has provided an abundant creation, enough for everyone, and we are called to act. We start by listening to people. Listening to people in countries all over the world and around the corner about what they need. People know their own communities best, and it's our job to listen to them and help connect them to the resources that they assure us will help lift themselves out of poverty. What's unique about ELCA World Hunger is the comprehensive approach. We work both internationally in over 60 countries and domestically here in the United States through relief, development, education, and advocacy. The relief work helps people meet immediate needs. ELCA World Hunger works to support congregations who are running soup kitchens, food pantries, and homeless shelters. We know that we are called to feed the poor. We shelter people. We provide basic medical care, all of these essential things that everyone needs to survive. But the biggest part of our work is not the relief work. It's the long-term sustainable development work. It's helping people connect to the resources they need to help their communities and their families thrive. And that development work involves access to clean water, sustainable agriculture, livestock, education, healthcare, job training, and microloans for women. We also know that the churches can't do it all. We need governments and corporations to do their part, and that's why we do advocacy. We speak out to public officials on behalf of and with poor and hungry people, asking for fair and just policies. And we know that to do this work, to do all of this work, we need to educate ourselves as a church, to educate ourselves about the causes and solutions to hunger, educate ourselves about the ways we can get involved, educate our children in Sunday school so that they will grow up knowing that they can make a difference in the world. When we engage in this work and in learning about this work, not only are lives transformed around the world, but our own lives are transformed. You can make a difference in the lives of hungry people around the world. You can get involved in ELCA World Hunger work. Learn about the root causes of hunger and the sustainable solutions. Pray and give generously. It's your gifts that make all this work possible. It may be our hands, but it is God's work.
Precisely an organization like ELCA World Hunger, that institutions like ours, buildings like ours, united together, can make a difference in the lives of so many people. And as we approach Thanksgiving and the holiday season, I would invite you to consider ELCA World Hunger or one of the many other institutions that we support through this congregation as a way in which we can expand the reach and the realm of God's love and purpose into our lives and into our world. At this time, I invite you to receive the benediction. And as we go out into this week, may the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord's face shine on us and be gracious to us. And may the Lord's holy countenance smile down upon us all and give us peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And our closing hymn is number 848. Have a great evening. Don't forget next week, 5 o'clock. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.